Hi everyone, and welcome back to Irish Health Hour Chats, where we meet somebody in the community that has a great story to tell us. And so we're focusing on different kinds of stories every week, which is great. And it's also a great way for us to get to know people and what they do. Now, today's Irish Health Hour Chats is all about a topic that I've been talking about having more conversation on, and it's to do with chronic pain. An awful lot of people suffer, some people even in silence, with pain. Personally, I have a back issue, which is not chronic, but when it's bad, it's bad. But I always think that pain, and back pain especially, isn't something tangible. We can't actually see a back pain. And I know my children often joke when I say I can't sweep the floor because my back is sore, because I can't actually show them something. So, you know, this conversation around having someone who has suffered with chronic pain for a long time and learned how to adapt her life as best she can. And it's a conversation I hope to continue on more of and chat about more, to hear other people's stories and to how they get through and cope. So today I am so delighted to have on Colette Coughlan, a great friend at this stage, having met her on Irish Health Hour and through the Women Inspire Network. Colette, hello.
Good morning. How are you, Dolores?
It's great to have you here.
Nice. You to ask me, indeed. And I must say, I love Irish Health Hour. It's a brilliant hour. And it's a great hour for networking, getting information. And I must say, it's a great way to wake up on a Saturday morning.
Well, thanks for that, Colette. And you are a great supporter of it. And I know that at times that it can be difficult for you to come along with the way that your life is. So would you like to let us know your story around, you know, I suppose you weren't born with chronic pain, and how it developed and how you have adapted your life around it, because you do so much yourself.
Well, I suppose I was what I'd call a fully functioning member of the human race up until the 12th of October, 95. We just moved home and I was going to a meeting. And I can remember Marion Finucane was on the radio and was talking about some lady who was dying of cancer, and I thought, oh my God, that I've got two small children, a really bad marriage, and I need to be there for my children. And then it had been an absolutely beautiful summer, just beginning to start to slightly rain, and I thought, oh, the road's going to be slippy, better be careful. And the next thing, I went to turn right in a place called Balrothery outside Balbriggan, and a guy behind me in a Jeep hit me three times, hit me behind, hit me on my side door, and hit me on my passenger door, and then kind of, I suppose, put me in the way of an oncoming juggernaut, because I was on the other side of the road. And I didn't realize for a few months, until an assessor was with me, that my foot had remained on the clutch, and that I actually had driven out of the way of this guy. Now, I only heard the noise of the guy in the Jeep behind me. So the only visual, I suppose, a part of this accident I had was actually the look on this driver's face as he narrowly avoided me.
My goodness.
I can remember two ladies coming over to the car, and I had to climb out the window to get out. And they were just so kind, because they kind of just, you know, you're shocked, and they just grounded me. No mobile phone. So the guy with me, he was a young guy, and he was a little bit all over the place. And I'm telling him, ring the police and whatever. And then I'm more worried about the fact that I had a meeting and I was going to be late. So It was adrenaline was really taking over. And I can remember getting somebody in a house next door to ring the gentleman that I had the meeting with to say that I would be late. And I would be a type A personality, like, there's a goal, you just go straight ahead, that's it. So I even remember measuring the road with the Garda. And I was there when the guy was cautioned with dangerous driving or whatever. And then when the guard had finished with me, I asked him to check that my indicators on my lights were working okay. Got into the car, and I had to drive up a little side road. And I was in shock. I now realise I was in shock, but I was delighted that, I suppose, there was no traffic. And I got to the house, and the man, after about maybe three, I suppose I apologised profusely when I went in, and after less than 5 minutes, he took a phone call. And then it, like, it struck me like thunder. I've nearly been killed.
Mm.
And then the pain just set in. And when I finished with him, I can remember driving home. And at one point, there's an intersection, the Derry Road, the main road going out of Dublin, and there was traffic back there. And I didn't know whether to get out of the car, lie on the floor, lie on the roof, or what to do. And when I got home, I lay on the floor, and I've been lying on many floors, both good and absolutely horrible, for many, many years. And I didn't go to the doctor that evening because I had seen a program. I'd seen a doctor on the Late Late Show. Actually, he's the doctor that my sons had gone to. And he said that anyone who said they'd whiplash was looking for money. But if I go to a doctor, he's just going to think I'm looking for money. So the next day, I was just so bad and in such pain, I went to the doctor and he sent me for x-rays or whatever. And my whole thing was, when am I going to be better? I didn't have time to be sick. And he said, 6 weeks. So I literally had 6 weeks a day marked in my diary, and life was going to be so different. And it wasn't.
Wow.
And it just, I suppose, the pain, I can't even remember where the pain was initially, because it was, I can remember being in my neck, in my head, but it's now all over my body, from the tip of my toe to the top of my head.
So you still suffer from this chronic pain on a daily basis, don't you?
On a daily basis.
And it's amazing all the different points that came up there. I mean, you went into shock, you know, you were there, you were helping the policeman with the markings on the road. It's amazing how our body just goes into
Was adrenaline. Absolutely. I can just say, because my whole I suppose focus was, I'm late for a meeting.
Yeah.
End of story. You know, and that was it. And then it was just when he took that phone call, that's when I suppose the rational side of my brain took over, and then the pain just took over. And, you know, I mean, I suppose better start off to say there are two types of pain. There's acute pain, which is actually, that's what you would call a good pain, because in acute pain, if you put your hand on a hot hob or a hot pan, you get burned. It tells you you're in danger. Please remove your hand. If you've got your hand in the mouth of a dog and it's biting you, that's telling you, you know, get your hand away. Whereas chronic pain serves absolutely no purpose at all. And chronic pain is described as any pain that's longer than 3 months. And at that stage, once your central nervous system goes out of kilter, after 3 months or more, it has absolutely no conception as to how to go back. So you're left with this chronic, I mean, you can have chronic back pain, you could have chronic pain in your shoulder or whatever. I just have it all over. I would have had, you know, problems with my neck, problems with my thoracic spine, which is your mid spine, problems with my lower spine, with my head, my jaws, my eyes, costochondrosis, which is pain in your kind of chest, your rib area. And then you've got all these knock-on effects within your body. I would have adrenal fatigue now. I have problems with my liver, problems with my kidney, irritable bowel, irritable bladder. So it's just like this kind of just knock-on effect.
So you're really you're systematic all over your body, really, it sounds like. But that wasn't the only that was the initial, I suppose, road traffic accident that caused it. But then other things happened I suppose, make it worse.
Yeah, I suppose going back to initially, you know, you start off and you think, because this doctor said you're going to be better in 6 weeks, I was just waiting for this 6 weeks, and then nothing happened. And I had my own business. I loved what I did. I didn't have time to be sick. I didn't want to be sick. I didn't accept being sick. And I suppose it was like I just kept on going, and I didn't give into it. And then you start on this merry-go-round of doctors between, you know, well, the pain specialist came later, but you're sent to orthopedic guys, then you're sent to, like, everybody, because when you various different things wrong with your body. So you're literally going to five or six. Then I was doing kind of alternative medicine, reflexology. I even saw an ad once on the back of the Irish Times for a lady to talk to my muscles. So if anybody promised me anything and they were charging the sun, moon, and stars, I would have gone to them.
Mm-hmm.
Just thought, don't want to be like this. Don't agree with being like this. This is affecting my career. It's just, and pain. You start off, I think, the way I look at it is, I was a normal person on the 12th of October, 95. And within 2 years, I ended up like a basket case.
Mm.
I would say it was the fact that, A, I didn't respect my illness. I remember the October 95, I did 50 television programs in 14 days. And everything, like the whole set came back to my house. And then I was in the RDS for 5 days with 3 shows a day. So that's just like, that's not a 9-to-5 job. That's busy, busy, busy.
Yeah.
And then I...
So emotionally, you know, do you think that, you know, you said you didn't want to accept it almost. Emotionally, were you sort of denying that your body was in pain?
Was I denying? It was like, you know, I don't want this. This is not in my plan. That was it. And I remember after the RDS, I went to Birmingham to a food show, and I just didn't realize I wasn't well. I sat all day. I knew one of the directors, there are various shows on there, and they were doing actually This Is Your Life on Marguerite Patton. And I just sat in the director's box all day, went home the next day, and opened a bottle of wine at lunchtime. And I thought, this is not right. This just isn't right. Now, I had a doctor before that I always said I would hate him to have, to make a life or death decision on me. And I would go to him saying, I just can't cope with this pain. This is just dreadful. And he'd say, are you sure you've got pain now? Are you sure now? Where's the pain coming from? And you just feel you're not believed.
Yeah.
And then the day I opened the bottle of wine, I thought, that's bad. And the next day I was just feeling so bad. And I went to a local medical center that my physiotherapist had said wonderful things about. And I just found the most wonderful, wonderful doctor. And the first thing she said to me was, who is managing your care? And I kind of thought for a second, and I said, I am. And I was the one bringing myself to all the different people looking for this cure. And she said to me, okay, we're going to try and streamline this. We're just going to think about it, work on it. And she said, now I want to see you back in 2 weeks. She saw me back in 2 weeks. And at that stage, I didn't want to go out. I was crying. I didn't want to let my now ex-husband know, because, I mean, I was there to have meals ready, shirts ironed, and whatever else. And the only person who knew how I felt was the lady who came in to look after my sons in the afternoon. And my GP then said to me one day, what do you think is going to happen? And I said, well, you know, if I continue like this, I'm going to end up depressed. Now, depressed was not a word in my vocabulary.
Yeah, you're very strong, ladies, what's coming across.
Yeah, and she said to me, well, you know, I think you are. I'd like you to come back now in 10 days. So went back in 10 days and I still wasn't feeling any better. And this was coming up to Christmas. So she said to me, I think we need to put you on a light antidepressant. So I can remember taking it at Christmas and waking up the next morning. It was like somebody put cotton wool in my head. Yeah. And at the same time, it was like nobody knew I was feeling the way I was. I was just putting on this
facade.
I can remember being in my parents' house that Christmas, and I can even remember my brother, my mum and my dad holding my legs on the stairs. Like I was, in order to kind of, I suppose it was like traction. So I was facing head down the stairs and somebody was holding my legs and then somebody was pulling my shoulders for traction and just lying down. And then I suppose it was 97, about, I worked with this doctor, but I was put on medication. I'd seen a pain specialist at that stage. I was advised to see this pain specialist. And so, therefore, you get into this other area and put on different medications. So you start off being put on, I suppose, epileptic drugs, because what they do is they affect kind of the neurons and what's going on in your brain, and it's supposed to dampen down the pain. And between the antidepressant and that, oh my God, it was like looking at a bigger version of myself every day.
Wow.
Mm. And I was always thin and I hated that. Absolutely hated it.
Yeah.
So, and I was still trying to work and not give in to it. And I can even remember one day meeting a PR guy, and we're meeting these clients, and we were in my favorite Michelin star restaurant. And I was sitting outside listening to a relaxation tape. My body was just in a state of absolute high anxiety, not over the meeting. I mean, I knew my stuff, but I now realize it was adrenal fatigue.
Right.
Okay. So, and I can remember I knew the PR guy really, really well. And when I went in, I just said to him, I need a Valium sandwich, not lunch. And the clients were saying to me, you know, is the lunch okay? You're not eating a lot. So I said, well, I've had a tummy bug, and you kind of just pass it all over. You do the work, you smile, you feel absolutely dreadful. How I would describe depression when I had it, it was like a monkey on my back. I wanted to get up, and it was like this force just pushing you down. Now, in saying that, at the same time, I became a board member of what was the Irish Chronic Pain Association at that stage, because you realize at some point when you get into this whole cycle that you, in the beginning, if a doctor said to me, do X, I'd say, fine, you know, how high do you want me to jump? But then you realize you really have to be even more informed than the doctors, because pain, in the beginning you alluded to it, pain is not an organic thing. You know, you don't have a foot growing out of your head. You don't have a big lump on your back. You don't have whatever. And, you know, from speaking to people in the College of Surgeons when I was with Irish Chronic Pain, the doctors at that stage, about 12 years ago, 1% of their training revolved around chronic pain, and that was really to do with palliative care. I've been brought into hospital by ambulance on 3 or 4 occasions to my local hospital, and have actually, after a while, discharged myself because you know, it's like I know more about it and I've got better drugs at home.
Well, how do you cope, Colette, like on a daily basis now? You know, I mean, so you never really recovered in any way. It seems like you almost got worse and you're emotionally, even though I know now that you actually have accepted it, obviously, but like your journey every day is...
Well, I suppose what helped me, my GP is just wonderful. And after about maybe 40 months with her, because she knew I just wasn't accepting this, she said, I think you need to see somebody and I want to talk to my partner to make sure it's the correct person. Now, that didn't mean anything to me at the time. I didn't realize that it is so important that you have somebody that you gel with and that's good. And I saw a cognitive behavioral therapist for years and he just the best thing that, oh my God, I don't know where I would have been without him.
Wonderful.
He did say to me that it took him 8 months to catch up with me. So that'll tell you how crazy I am. And I had to write a diary for him every day. And I said to him, I remember at one stage, I would absolutely do everything to do with my life. He kind of wanted me to accept my weight, because absolutely not accepting my weight, no way. Always thin, don't like being like this. Wouldn't buy clothes, wouldn't do anything. He did give me a challenge to buy clothes. It took me 6 weeks.
Wow.
I'm a clothesaholic. So, and I wouldn't even look at the size or do anything. And he said to me, the first day I wore in a trouser suit, he said, does it not feel well? And I said, well, I suppose the material looks nice. I said, but that's it. And
so sorry, Colette, when you, like, what was it about this cognitive behavioral therapy that changed? Is it because he just got you to more look at it from an emotional standpoint and from a behavioral standpoint, as opposed to dealing with the actual physical symptom? You were looking at it more as a whole picture of your emotional state around it.
I suppose the first thing he did was it took him so long to literally get the measure of me. But one of the things he did was this EMDR therapy, which is like you follow a pencil.
And it's done
at a certain speed. And I can remember at one point saying, and you're given a thought, and I remember at one point saying, oh, the juggernaut was red. I could remember the guy's face, but I couldn't remember anything.
Right.
And he brought me to the scene of my accident on two occasions, which was kind of really upsetting.
Yeah.
I suppose it was something you had to face. And then he dealt with my life as a whole in terms of, you know, everything that was going on, my marriage, people being ill, me being ill, teaching me, I suppose, how to be good to myself. And then in conjunction with him, I went, which was, I had my accident in 95. So in May 99, I was sent on a pain management program in St. Vincent's Hospital by my consultant. And I knew there was going to be about 8 people on it. So I thought I was going to walk in there and I was going to be 100 times better than everyone else. They were all going to be crocs. And my pain was hidden pain.
Mm.
I was the first person who had to actually stand up and sit on the floor. That annoyed me. But they weren't talking about your pain. They weren't talking about whether you had a pain in your back, your toe, wherever it was. They were talking about what pain did to you psychologically, emotionally, or whatever. And I remember just feeling like crying the whole day.
Yeah.
So every morning we started off with a psychologist and meditation. Then we would have social workers. An awful lot was based around psychology as to what pain literally does to you. Like explaining the pain gate theory. You've got two pain gates in your body. One in your spine, one in just at the start of your brain, and the pain gates are either closed or they're open. Alcohol opens them even further.
Oh.
One of the illnesses I was diagnosed with is fibromyalgia, which means that I have this neurotransmitter, this pain neurotransmitter. Say you're transmitter on your back would be as, like as if it's going up a boreen. Mine is like an autobahn. So it's like my whole pain processing is just totally amplified and out of kilter. And then,
Colette, sorry to interrupt you. Is your fibromyalgia brought on by chronic pain?
Yeah, by it would normally be brought on by some kind of shock, trauma. It can be childbirth, it can be an accident, it can be, there's a genetic component. So I have a cousin who's got fibromyalgia and also ME, which I have, which is fibromyalgia, ME and lupus are all first cousins of one another.
Okay.
So, and then I would also have neuropathic pain, which is kind of nerve pain in my lower back and going into my left leg.
But what is the future for you, Colette, now, as in relation to, you know, is it all just about pain management now? Like, is there a prognosis that will ever say, could you ever imagine yourself, or is there a prognosis of ever being pain-free?
Well, I'm always a positive person.
Yeah.
Always.
You certainly are, I know that.
Always say you have to have hope. If you don't have hope, you've got nothing. But at this moment in time, there's no cure. In the beginning, I could kind of do deals with my body over pain because I would be, I suppose, strong enough to cope with it. But then you see what coping with it did to me. But, you know, when the ME comes into it, that totally takes over. So it's a case of your thought on pain management, this word pacing.
Mm-hmm.
It's not going to be in the Oxford English Dictionary when I come back in the next life because it is just so boring. You've just got to think, you know, you've got to look at your diary for a week and there's not much in it, but you've got to make sure you've got to go somewhere for a meeting, even to meet somebody for coffee, that, you know, you've got to be rested, you've got to be lying down so that your pain isn't so bad. Even where you meet people, it's like, are the chairs comfortable? Are the cushions? Like even things like, you know, going to the theatre, just doing things for the hell of it. Everything is planned, absolutely planned to the nth degree. It's just, you know, if, like say my bath at the moment, I put stuff on it last week and my back was so bad, I just couldn't do anything. I can't clean it at the moment.
Mm.
Earl coming in tomorrow. Just really small things like that, that it's just everything just requires planning. And then say you're awake at night and like, you know, with a lot of chronic pain comes sleep disorder.
Mm.
You have stage one or two of sleep. So I don't have refreshing sleep. Even if I didn't have ME, there is a huge component of fatigue because you're dealing with this pain the whole time. And as I say, the pain serves no purpose. It's just, you know, a central nervous system that's gone totally askew. Looking back, I think it's dreadful that it was 4 years from when I had my accident to when I actually learned what pain does to you.
Right.
But there again, I was very lucky to get on a chronic pain program. I would do a lot of meditation. I would try and practice mindfulness. It is like just doing a 360 on your life.
Mm-hmm. What difference would it have caused, do you think, if you knew what pain did to you? When you say that, what are you alluding to exactly?
What's the duty? It just invades every single aspect of your life.
So that if you said you knew that closer to the time, if you were aware of that, do you think it would have helped you cope better?
Absolutely. You know, and I suppose up until I did the chronic pain program, I was looking for this cure.
Okay.
The program and you're kind of it dawns on you very, very quickly, and it's very, very hard to take that, that, you know, this is probably it, and that you've got to learn to cope with it, and you've got to learn to work within the parameters of whatever kind of pain is in your life. Mm-hmm. And if anyone had told that I would spend most of my life lying on a couch or in bed, I would have said, you know, on your bike, that's not me. I tried to continue working as long as I could. I tried to morph myself into different things within the industry I worked in. And then in the end, you have to, you know, having ME, you've got to be safe, you know, driving a car. So that speaks louder. And I remember actually reading a book by a doctor called Dr. Jacob Teitelbaum, and his book is From Fatigue to Fantastic. I'm waiting for the fantastic. By God, am I waiting? And
but you are fantastic, Colette.
Yeah,
I say that.
Yeah.
But I say that as, you know, when I met you, I didn't know your story, let's say, and which is often the case when we meet someone for the first time. I knew you were the founder or a co-founder perhaps of Able Hour, a hashtag hour on a Thursday evening. But I wasn't aware that you actually were a chronic pain sufferer, because I saw this beautiful lady. We chatted at the Women Inspire event, and I didn't know your story really then. So you certainly don't appear as someone that is in any way down or, you know, suffering from anxiety or anything, because when you meet you, you're just, I love chatting to you.
Well, the sun changed my life. Oh my God, it's so changed it. Sheer fluke in 2012, I spent 3 months abroad, and the light, I would have had seasonal affective disorder as well.
And sorry to collect, was the seasonal affective disorder brought on again by chronic pain, or is this a separate, or is it something that's interlinked?
Oh, listen to me. Okay. It's, you know, the domino effect.
Okay.
And I would have had a light box. It absolutely really wouldn't have. To me, other people are different, and I can only speak for myself.
Sure.
It really didn't work. And then I mean, before I'd been abroad for a week here and there, and, you know, your pain certainly is different when, or certain types of your pain are different when you are kind of when you're in the heat, and it's all got to do with positive and negative ions and whatever else. But the sun, I began to kind of realize I don't produce cortisol, which is your get up and go hormone in the morning. And then when melatonin comes in at night, which is your sleep hormone, that doesn't come in the way it should. So I would spend nights, like, I just have a tiny light on, because once you turn light on, that's any melatonin you've built up. So I would maybe get up about 12 o'clock and go out into the living room, and this huge big window with this light, and I just gravitated towards it. It was like somebody, I can only describe it as somebody who has a cigarette, and you can see them really pulling on the cigarette and enjoying it. So I decided, you know, this is really good for me, and I feel really well, and I don't do things by halves, and I wouldn't really recommend this to anybody, but I just gave up these antidepressants like cold turkey and had no problem giving them up. And touch wood, I have never felt, my depression wasn't, I suppose, the normal type of depression. I thought I was the bee's knees, the cat's pajamas, and everything rolled into one. I thought the world was a wonderful place. I thought I was a valuable member of the human race, but there was just this monkey sitting on my back. After I came back from Spain that time, I discovered that Winston Churchill called it the black dog, and I could absolutely understand that. So I just now factor in going to Spain 2 or 3 times a year.
Wonderful.
I'm firmly convinced that most people in this northern hemisphere are vitamin D deficient.
Mm-hmm.
So what I do is I spend 20 minutes in the sun each day with no sunblock on, and then put on the, because you have to do that in order to absorb the vitamin D.
Sure.
And then put on factor 50.
Mm-hmm.
After that, and I go to my dermatologist every year, and I get him to look at my body to make sure. because it is a case of six of one and half a dozen of the other.
Yeah.
Do I, you know, stay out of the sun? But then if I stay out of the sun, I would not like to be back to where I was. Life is so different. I'm in control of me. I would say from the end of October, when the weather, when the evenings get dark, I hate it. Until, say, the end of January, I would be sluggish, but I certainly would be, you know, upbeat.
Yes.
And now I just say, right, I'll do that in the spring. It's a thing called, that I learned from this Jerry, this cognitive behavioral therapist, called radical non-intervention. Basically, you just acknowledge that maybe things need to be done, but you also acknowledge that you're not in a position to do them. So you just walk through things and ignore them.
Oh, wow. And that's wonderful.
Go and lie on the couch or go and do something else. But I do believe that, you know, even though I will say, oh, yes, I'm not going to do that, I do believe if everything is tidy around you, you're in a better frame of mind.
It's all energy, isn't it?
But, you know, hey ho, life isn't perfect. And that is it. But there are, you know, there's people, I would then support people and advocate for them who've got chronic pain. So, and it would be, you know, I've got one girl and I keep saying to her, look, do you practice your relaxation tapes? And she doesn't. So, you know, how do you deal with that? She's more into panicking. I have someone else then, and they just keep thinking about, well, person who did whatever it was to them that put them in the position they're in. And I'm saying, you know, the guy that hit me initially, he didn't set out to do, okay, he was charged with dangerous driving, but he didn't set out to do that. And that's negative energy. It's not going to make me any better. And I suppose the only thing now with my pain is that in the last few years, due to more trauma and that, I now walk with a limp. So that annoys me, because before that, my pain was my business. And if I chose to tell somebody about it.
Well, I never know. I never even noticed that, Colette. It's so that, funny you say that.
Well, all my nice high shoes are in the loft at this stage. And I now have shoe envy. I look at people's shoes and the higher they are, the better they are. My Uggs are my favorite things, and my slippers. Because I kind of feel grounded with that. But it's just, you know, you learn to deal with the migraine, you learn to deal with the vertigo, you learn to deal with, even when I go to the hairdressers, I need to get now shortly this, I've got most of the nerves in my body, this RPF, radio pulse frequency, where they actually laser the nerves. I've got them done here, which is just the sorest thing ever, and I would be black and blue. I said to the consultant, he's the only man who could give me a black eye and wouldn't be charged with GBH. I have a guy who looks after my jaws and I wear this splint. I've had my back done as well. I've had more MRIs to be banned. I've had back surgery. I've had a disectomy. I cannot feel my left, the outer aspect of my left leg. So it's, you know, I suppose if after 20 years I haven't accepted it, I never will. And I have.
We've lost you there momentarily, Colette. I just lost you there a little bit.
A phone call was coming through.
That's okay. I might just have you talk briefly about what your work that you do on Able Hour, because I think that there are a few, you know, for people that aren't familiar with what a hashtag hour is, there are some hashtag hours that happen during the week, and there are a few of them that are very, I suppose, orientated to a certain audience, like myself and my Irish Health Hour is a health and wellness community. We have Mental Health Hour, that's for people that have an interest in even or work in the mental health area. And then you have Able Hour.
Yeah. There's a crossover, or that. Hopefully these people aren't ringing again.
We'll just take it as it comes. It's okay. It's a live interview. So what is your your aim for Able Hour? Is it raising awareness, or?
I suppose how Able Hour came about was about 6 years ago, I joined the board of an independent living organization. And independent living is really about taking people out of congregated settings. Like years and years ago, if somebody had any kind of a disability, they were put into a home somewhere. And then this movement started in Ireland about 20 years ago. So from that, I got into the, I would attend the peer support group once a month. And last year, then when I was coordinating the group, I decided to try and do a project with the group rather than just, you know, we would sit, we would discuss things, we would feed in with Fingal County Council, we would do access audits, different things that would help people live in the community. Then Barbara Franzoni, who's also a member of Women's Inspire Network, I approached the Institute of Technology in Blanchardstown and was luckily given Barbara as the student to work with. She thought we were wonderful because I just handed over total control to her. I thought she was wonderful because she did absolutely everything. We were to do a documentary. She set us up with a Facebook account, Twitter account. She set up Able Hour. And the whole thing about Able Hour was to just raise awareness of people's ability and disabilities. And I suppose, you know, I hate the word disability because I would always kind of break it into two syllables, disability. And to me, disability is something that prevents you doing something. And we have...
I'm losing you a little bit there again. But Able Hour does go out every Thursday evening between 8 and 9 as far as off the top of my head. Getting that right, I'll just check it up here. So if anybody wants to find out more about Able Hour, they can find it on Twitter at the handle Able Hour.
I told the girl not to ring me again, I'd ring her.
No, sorry. That's fine. We're nearly at the top of the hour anyway, so I was just telling people there that Able Hour, it's 8 to 9 on a Thursday evening, isn't that right?
Correct. And the hashtag Able Hour. And it's not just talking about, I always say illness, because illness is a disability. On the website, I can remember writing, like, what is a disability in terms of if somebody wanted to come to our meetings, if they think they're not disabled enough, I suppose is the best word to describe it. A disability is a migraine.
Mm-hmm.
Disability is something that just prevents you. A disability is depression.
Mm-hmm.
If anything at all, and that is it. And also, if we were just to talk to the people, say, nationally, that we would know, well, then that's quite insular and we're learning nothing. So it's a case of networking, and you do a few of the hours like me and you get to know these people. And as Samantha Kelly says, you know, when you meet them, it's hugs, not handshakes. And I think that's a really, really good saying. And I enjoy doing them. And disability can be isolating. You know, I know when I start talking to Siri quite a bit and ask Siri, will he marry me? And, you know, they're stuff. And all of these kind of stupid things that I need to get out and see somebody.
Well, you're an inspiration, Colette, to a lot of people, even though you may not feel it, or I hope you do. But if you were to give somebody, or if you were to give us just a quick nugget of information as to someone, let's say, that is maybe just at the beginning of a journey of you know, just after having an incident of chronic pain, what would you say to them?
Be kind to yourself.
Okay.
Because I wasn't. And be accepting. Now, be accepting doesn't mean that you've got to totally give in,
mm-hmm.
Or whatever. But just, I believe you always have to live with hope. I mean, there's a drug trial going on in Norway at the moment. It's more on the ME spectrum, but I kind of believe, you know, if something works for ME, the potential of working for fibro, you know, could be there as well. And I think just if I had listened to my body in the beginning, my biggest thing in my head was, what is it about me that I can't get better?
Okay.
And I thought there was something intrinsically wrong with me. And for somebody who I, in my 20s, I had achieved something, you know, quite good. And a lady sent me a card saying, limits exist only in one's mind. And it wasn't until I found it in my late 30s that I actually realized what she was saying. Because limits did exist only in my mind. And, you know, there was no limits when it came to chronic pain. And I just needed to, maybe if I was still working, I worked in banking for 15 years and hated it. Maybe if I was worked in banking, I would be sitting at home, put my feet up, might be better, but I don't do postmortems. I am where I am. Mm-hmm. And I just have to learn to cope as best as I can.
That's great, Colette. So I suppose if people want to
relaxation is another thing. Okay. Really, really, really important.
So I suppose people can contact by dropping into Able Hour. Would that be the best thing for people to do if they want to join a community of like-minded people or just want support? They want to share blogs or whatever?
Absolutely. Or they can go to the Dublin 15 Disability Peer Support Group. My email address, ColetteCoughlan7@gmail.com, is there, gmail.com.
Can you give us that again? Dublin 15?
The Dublin 15 Disability Peer Support Group.
Wonderful.
And my contact details are there.
And that's a website as opposed to Twitter. There's Twitter as well, I know, but is there a website there?
That's a website.
A website, wonderful.
To do it. And also I would advise, the biggest thing is I would advise somebody to get a GP who is sympathetic towards the, I know from my time in Irish chronic pain, I remember a girl being told by a doctor, do you have a boyfriend? Because if they have a boyfriend, you wouldn't be feeling like this. Now, I've never known any man to uncomplicate one's life. They seem, maybe it's just me being very cynical, they seem to complicate lives more. But my GP, who listened to me and continues to listen to me, is my lifeline. And I advise, change your GP. If you've got a GP who doesn't believe in it, change your GP.
Oh, that's wonderful, Colette. Thank you so much for coming on to Irish Health Hour Chats and chatting to us, because it's not easy to tell your story, you know, and it's great. I'm delighted you did, as I say, because it's a conversation I'd like to continue sometime in the future. And also, you know, would advise people to get on to Able Hour. And even if you want to just look for the first while, you don't have to jump in and get involved. I think some people, that's what I like about the hashtag hours. I know certainly myself, is that you can go on and you can look. You might just pick up a nugget of little of hope. As Colette talked about, you might hear a story that someone else has and realize you're not alone. And it might give you that hope, that piece of rope to grab onto, to get hope. You might find that you'll get involved with the networking. And there again, it's all about just the mindset.
I think it's the networking. It's just talking to the people. It's learning things. It's then taking the conversation into a DM, maybe then to a telephone call, maybe to a meeting. I mean, I hope to come to Galway to your next network.
Lovely.
Group. And I think that's what it's about. I could sit at home and just lie on the couch and watch television and just think, poor me, woe is me. But, you know, I try and pace myself to get out there and do different things, because otherwise your mind just can become mush. And that's what I like about the live hours. It's like my brain will do, and there is an element of a thing called fibro fog and memory and whatever else, and sometimes I begin to think I have a little bit of Alzheimer's. But what I like about that is I can be lying on the couch in my PJs and my brain is firing on all cylinders and my body is quite comfortable. Oh, and it's making friends via Twitter, networking, and hearing other people's stories, because you can't always just think about yourself.
Oh, that's
always somebody worse off than you were.
That's so true. Very good point.
Yeah,
thanks again.
So listen, thank you so much indeed, Dolores, and continued success with the Irish Health Hour. And I look forward to contributing on the Saturdays.
Lovely. And we always love to have you. And I do try to get on Able Hour. It's my child's bedtime. So that's why hashtag hours in the evening don't always work, because my child goes to bed at that time. But I do try sometimes.
And it's important that they get to bed at that time. Otherwise, you miss that little window and they're hyper.
And then mommy can't, then mommy's, my story starts going then, that I need some time on my own. As you say, like, that would be something I value, is my little piece of time at the end of the evening for just me, maybe, or to plan my following day.
As somebody who was very gregarious, somebody who always had people to dinner, supper, barbecues, everything else, I now love my own space. And do you know, as a final thing, just as the work I did with Jerry, if I had been me, this go-getter, I wouldn't have been aware as to how I tick or what makes me tick or how I work. I know everything about myself now, and it's been a journey of self-discovery, and also I'm very much in touch with nature, and for that I'm really, really grateful. Mm. Now, when I actually said that to him, I said, I don't believe I'm saying this, because it's been a horrible journey, but at the same time, you have to take something positive out of it.
Oh, that's wonderful. Fair play to you. Love it. And thanks for that final piece of inspiration. Colette, we shall chat to you very soon. And thank you so much again.
You're very welcome indeed. Thanks indeed, Dolores. Okay.
Colette. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.